still on question number 10, but the big part now, and for me, we have Roman figure 1. Roman figure 1 says, find the equation of the normals to the curve y equals x squared minus 1 at a point where it cuts the x-axis. So we are we are looking for the equation of the normals to this curve at the point where it cuts the x-axis. Let me quickly explain some things here. In mathematics, whenever you hear the word normals, we're talking about perpendicularity. Whenever you hear the word tangential, we're talking about being parallel. So this thing, normals, similar to perpendicular, and tangent parallel. Yeah. So when you're dealing with something of this nature, thinking of this. Now we're looking for the equation of the normals for this. But let's quickly do a recap from coordinate geometry. One of the things coordinate geometry helps us understand is that whenever you have lines now, not curves, just ordinary lines, if you have two lines, if you have perpendicular lines and you have parallel lines, let's say this one has slope to be m1 or the gradient, slope or gradient, it can be used interchangeably. Now this one has slope m2. Say with these two lines, from coordinate geometry we have the understanding that the multiplication of these two equals minus one, and this one will have the same slope, but any two parallel lines. So we'll still make use of this information as well. So take care of that. Now we know this, we have this. So this one is talking about perpendicular lines. This one is talking about parallel lines. Now, don't forget, we are looking for the equation of the normals at the point where this curve cuts the x-axis. Now, the next thing I need to get, I need a point. I actually need a point on the y-axis. I need a point on the curve. I don't need to know a point on the curve. That is where I know what x is and what y is. Now, what does it mean for a curve to cut a particular axis? You know, if we are in the 2D plane, we talk about the x-axis and we talk about the y-axis. Now, what do we mean by a curve or any graph? What do we mean by cutting x-axis? What do we mean by cutting y-axis? If a curve should cut x-axis, let me just give you a sketch here. Now, this is my y-axis, this is my x-axis. Now, you see a curve, let's say I have this curve, this is a curve. This is a line, a straight line. Let me draw another curve, one more curve. Yeah, this is another curve. As you can see, these things, they are places whereby they cut the x-axis. They cut the x-axis here, here, and here. But one thing is that, just trace this place that they cut the x-axis. Just trace it to y-axis and see the value of y. You see that the value of y is uniform for all of them. And what is it? Let's see. If you trace it now, this is our point zero. So if you trace this place, what's the answer? If you trace this place to this place, trace this place to this place, trace this place to this, you realize that the value of y at that point will be zero. The same thing happens for when a curve cuts the y-axis. Whenever a curve is cutting the y-axis, then the value of x at that point will be zero. So for this, and as you can see, this is a quadratic equation. So we have a quadratic graph, and quadratic graph, most likely, if you cut the x-axis in two places, then the value of y in those two places will be zero. So let's see what will happen now. Okay, I can click this sketch. So from here, I would have something like, since we know that the value of y where this curve cuts the x-axis will be equal to zero, that implies that x squared minus 1 equals to zero at that point. So this implies that x squared equals to 1, and we have that x equals to plus or minus 1. X equals to plus or minus 1. So if we now have this, that implies that we have two points now. We have point minus 1, comma 0, and we have 0.1, 0. In fact, I needed 1 point. Now I've gotten 2 points. So let's see. But at each point, we can always find a normal to this curve. At each point, so we'll find the normal to the, we'll find the equation of the normal to this curve at these 2 points. So let, we'll do for this. So let's proceed. Now, as we have gotten those 2 points, the next thing we need to get now. Let me write the points here. -1, 0 and 1, 0. We have -1, 0 and 1, 0. So the next thing I need to get, don't forget, whenever you are talking about equation of something from a curve and all those things, you need the gradient or the slope. Now, this M1 and M2 that we're talking about, they actually deal with slope. So I need to get my slope out of this place. Now, for the normals to this curve, they will follow this rule. They will follow this rule. And it's for every normal that you want to, for every normal line to this curve, they will follow that their gradient at a particular, if you pick the gradient at the same point, so this the gradient of this curve at a point, and the gradient of the line that is normal to it at that point, if you multiply the gradient, that is the slope together, you will get a result of -1. But if it is equation of tangent, you know, you can have many tangents. So if the equation of tangent at a particular point, the equation of the slope, the gradient of this curve, it will be the same as the slope of any line that is tangent to it at that same point. That's what I am saying. That's what this equation is saying. So it is important that I find the what? That I find the slope of this. So by finding the slope of this, using this relationship, I'll be able to get the equation of the line that is normal to this curve. And I'm going to get the slope of the line that is normal to this point. And once I get the slope and I have a point on it, then the equation, because one of the necessary things that you need to find the equation of a normal of a line now is you need a slope and a point on that line. Those two things, they are necessary and sufficient. Or you have 2 points on that line. But so here I can get the slope, and obviously I have a point where I'll be referencing. So let me see. For this case now, our slope, let me call it M1, which is what? Dy dx. Don't forget, this will be equal to 2x. Yeah, 2x, ordinary 2x. So at 1, 0, M1 will be equal to 2. That is, I'm inserting this point there. I'm inserting this now. Now, at -1, 0 now, what will happen? M1 will then be equal to what? That's -1 times 2. That's -2. So, I have two slopes now. So, let me take this one first into consideration. Now, let me get my M2. M2 will be the slope of the normal to this curve. So, M2... multiply by M1, we know is equal to -1. We know that will be equal to -1. This implies that M2 multiply by what's our M1? M1 for this case we have times 2 equals -1, which implies that M2 equals -1/2. M2 equals -1/2. Now, we've gotten the M2 now, and we have a point on it, which is what? 1, 0. Don't forget, this one I'm using, I cannot use -1, 0, because the slope I'm using now, which is 2, was gotten as a result of the point 1, 0. So don't make the mistake, don't confuse them. So I'm using M2 equals to -1/2 now, and I'm making use of this point. So that is enough. And you know from our coordinate geometry, we know that slope is equal y minus y1 over x minus x1. X and y are arbitrary, just that they are from the same point. X1 and y1, they are known values, and they are coming from the same point on that line. So now, what do I do? This implies that what's my m? M2 is the slope I'm using, and that's -1/2 will be equal to y minus, what's y1? y1 is 0, and x minus, what's x1? According to what I'm using, x1 is 1. So, by the time you do this, you cross multiply, you have that 2y will be equal to minus x, then plus 1. That's this, not minus 1 multiplied by x minus 1, that's minus 1 times x is minus x. Minus 1 times minus 1, that's plus 1. Then 2 times y minus 0 is y. Then 2 times y is what? Is 2y. So finally, I can write this as this. 2y plus x minus 1 equals 0. So that's one equation. Let's keep that equation for now. Now, for the second stage now, so I will still use this same thing. So instead of writing this again, I will just continue from here. So instead of minus 2 now, instead of 2, I will have minus 2. That's for the second point I will have. So I will have minus 2. And by the time we do that, that will imply that m2 will be equal to... So for m1 equals minus 2. So we have m2 will be equals minus 1 all over minus 2, which is what? 1 over 2. So if that's the case now, then we have it that using this same equation, 1 over 2 equals y minus 0. Yes, y1 is still 0 here. This is x1, this is y1, this is x1, this is y1. But this time around, our x1 is minus 1. So we have x minus minus 1, so which is equal to y over x plus 1. So by the time I cross multiply this and this, this implies that 2y equals now what? 1 times x plus 1, that's equals x plus 1. And this will be 2y minus x minus 1 equals 0. As you can see, now look at the two equations. Look at the two equations. The only thing that is different from both of them is the what? Is the only thing that is different from both of them is this part. Minus, we have minus xa and we have plus xa. That's just the difference between the two of them. So these two now are the equations of the normal to this curve, and that's it. If it were to be tangent, the equation of the tangent to this curve, so we don't need to do this. All we just have to do is what? Since the slope is 2x, so at this point is m1 is 2, so we'll make use of 2 for this case, and for this point we'll make use of minus 1 minus 2 instead of having our 1 over 2. So I believe that's very, very clear. So that's how to go about that. Digest that, and let's solve another question. Okay, I have a question here. Still on that same question number 10. It says, find the coordinates, that's 10b, Roman figure 2 now. Say, find the coordinates of the point of intersection of the normals in B above. Okay, we are looking for the coordinate of the point of intersection. Don't forget we have 2y. plus x minus 1 equals to 0, and we have 2y minus x minus 1 equals to 0. So these are the two equations. This is very, very simple. So we are looking for the coordinates of the point of intersection. There's a place where they intersect. So let's look for the coordinate of this point. This is just like a simultaneous equation. So we just solve simultaneously. So if I subtract equation 2 from equation 1, subtracting equation 2 from equation 1, and 2y minus 2y, that's 0. X minus minus x, that's 2x. Because that would be x plus x, that's 2x. Then this would be minus 1 minus minus 1. That would be 0 as well. And this would be equal to 0. That implies that x is equal to 0. X equals to 0. And if x equals to 0, then I just insert into any of this expression here. So what do we have? We have that 2y plus 0 minus 1 equals to 0. So this will be that 2y minus 1 equals to 0, which implies that
y will equals to 1 over 2 if you do this very well.
So the point of intersection is
0, 1 over 2 because x is 0 there and y is what? 1 over 2 there. So that's the point where these two,
that's the point of intersection of the normals. As you can see, we had two normals to that curve. We had two normals to it. Now, it happens that we have to find the coordinates of the point where these two normals intersect. So the coordinate of the point where the two numbers intersect is 0, 1 over 2. So at 0, 1 over 2, those two numbers intersect. But generally, whenever you want to find the coordinate of points where maybe a curve intersects the line or anything, any line intersects with the graph, any graph intersecting, if you want to find the coordinate of the point where they intersect, all you have to do is what? Equate them. So you can solve them simultaneously or just equate the... You can make y square formula here, make y square formula here, then you just express them in terms of each other that you find. But the best way is to solve simultaneously, and you're fine. So we are settled with that question like that. Let me look for another beautiful question here. Now I have a question that says that a function g is defined by g of x equals 3 minus 4x all over x squared plus x minus 6. I'm still in 2011. 3 minus, that's g of x, is defined as 3 minus 4x over x squared plus x minus 6. So I have to resolve this into partial fraction. That's what the question wants me to do. How do we resolve into partial fraction? Now, let me give you some hints about resolving into partial fraction. But one thing you should know is that when I'm dealing with partial fraction, the denominator is one of the major concern, one of the things that you should concern yourself with. Now, if you have a linear denominator, if you're a student of further mathematics, you should know what linear means. You should know what a linear equation means. So, what does a linear equation mean? Any equation of the form, now look at 3 minus 4x is linear. Why? Because the highest power of the variable here is power 1. X is raised to power 1, and that's the highest power that I have here. This is a quadratic denominator because what I have what? Power 2 as the highest power of the denominator. Now, if I have something like this as the denominator now, I will assign, now, by writing it on the right-hand side, okay, let me say I have something like b over linear, like, I'm just writing this as a general form. Now, this is a linear expression, linear 1, another linear expression, linear 2. Let's say I now have quadratic expression. I'm still coming to this quadratic expression. Let me quickly deal with linear first. So what I will do is that I'll just, since it is a linear, I'll just go and bring a constant from somewhere. This b might be a function of x. Let's note that. This b is a function of x. That is, it's something that can be written in form of x, like 3 minus 4x now. Or it can even be a constant. We don't, that one is not our business. Now, L1 and L2, they are linear expressions just like this. Can be 2 plus x, can be x minus 4, can be 3x minus 5, and anything like that. So, L1 and L2 can be any of these things. So, if I want to, the first step I'll do is that I'll write an expression on this right hand side. But what will determine the expression I'm writing on the right hand side is the kind of denominator I have here. But since I have linear, the first linear, I'll just pick a constant, a random constant. That's an arbitrary constant. You can just pick any letter that you like. You can pick A. You can say A over L1. That's the first thing you do. A is a constant, just a number. It can be 2, it can be 4, it can be 5. We have to solve for it later. So that be a constant that you don't know over L1. Now the next thing you do is, okay, L2, because you have another linear expression, you go and look for another constant. Don't use this B again. You can use C over what? L2. So if you have a set of linear denominators on like that, that's how you continue to do it. Now, a special case is that let's say I have a repeated linear denominator. This is what we mean by repeated. That is, your linear expression is raised to a particular power. So it's raised to power 2, raised to power 3. Now, in that situation, yes, you start from here because this is linear. So you start from C over L2. But you don't stop there because it is repeated. Then you now look for another constant again. Let's say D over the same L2. Now, this time around, it will be raised to power 2. I believe you get that now. If it is L2 raised to power 3, so you pick another constant again over L2 raised to power 3. That's how you do for repeated linear denominators. So you start from the one without power, you go to the less power until you reach the highest power that it has. That's for linear. Now for quadratic now, let me use k of x now over quadratic 1, quadratic 2 squared. Now, mind you, there's something I should pay attention to very well. Whenever you're dealing with quadratic denominators, it is important that you check if the quadratic expression is factorizable. Yeah. If it is what? Factorizable. If it is factorizable, then you should break it down to linear expressions. And it's factorize the quadratic expression into linear expressions. That's the first thing you should do before you start resolving anything. And once you have factorized it into linear expression, then you follow the rule above. But if it is not like that, then for every quadratic that you want to do, this is a quadratic, let me not put square there, just quadratic expression. Now, for this quadratic now, if I want to write it there, let's say it cannot be factorized. If it cannot be factorized, then I'll just have, I'll look for a linear expression to use to express this. A linear what? Expression. That would be my numerator over the quadratic. And how does a linear expression look like? You know, it's always take the form ax plus b. And this, there will be a term that we're multiplying x, like a constant multiplying x, plus a constant that is standing alone. So we have this as our numerator over the quadratic expression that we have. Now, plus, now don't forget the rule also holds. If we have repeated quadratic, it's just the same way, just that the numerator you'll be assigning this time around, it's going to be a linear numerator and not a constant. So that's just how it goes. Now, in this, let's say Q2 cannot be factorized. If Q2 can be factorized, let's say Q2 is two linear multiplying each other. Let's say we have L3 multiplied by L4. You give us Q2. Then this will just be, we just choose another, and that will be C over L3 plus D over L4. As you can see, so this will re-express this other thing. They will now solve for A, B, C, and D. That's if Q3 is factorizable. So as you can see now, I've chipped in all those ones. Let's now see what we have here. X squared plus X minus 6. Is this thing factorizable? I can easily check, you know, from the general form of the quadratic expression, AX squared plus BX plus C. So in this case, my A is 1, B is 1, and C equals minus 6. There's a way we check if a quadratic expression is factorizable. This one, you don't need to write this one inside your answer sheet. It's just a way of checking. So let's check our B squared minus 4AC. Let's see what it will give. B squared has 1 squared minus 4 multiplied by A is 1 and C is minus 6. So we have this to be 1 minus 4 times minus 6, that's minus 24. And if you do this very well, you have 25. Wow. So that means that this expression is what? Factorizable. How do I know? Whenever you find your b squared minus 4ac and b squared minus 4ac, which is known as the discriminant of a quadratic expression or quadratic equation, whenever you find that and you get a perfect square, that implies that that quadratic expression is factorizable. So take note of that today. So this thing is factorized because 25 is a perfect square. So it's factorizable. All I need to do now is to look for the factors. I need to look for the factors. So the first thing you do is you multiply the coefficient of this with the constant term, that's minus 6, and 1 is our b. So you look for two numbers that you would multiply that will give you minus 6, and two numbers that you add together that will give you 1. But the numbers must be the same for the two operations that I want to perform. And if you do that very well, that will be 3 times minus 2, 3 plus minus 2. This will do. So 3 and minus 2 are my factors. So if you factorize that very well, if we do that very well, so since we have 3 and minus 2, that implies that, can say by factorizing, by factorization, x squared plus x minus 6 is the same thing as x plus 3 times x minus 2. So, we do that, so which implies that g of x cannot be written in a new form. It cannot be written as 3 minus 4x over x squared plus x minus 6 equals, so 3 minus 4x over x plus 3 multiplied by x minus 2. So this quadratic now has been written in linear form now. So this is a linear expression. That's how I just assign a constant. Let me choose constant as a. So that's a over x plus 3 plus b over x minus 2. So that's what I was trying to explain the other time. So I have two linear expressions, so I've expressed them that way. Now the next thing I will do now is, okay, I will multiply through by this. I'll multiply this expression through by this, by x plus 3 times x minus 2. So when you do that, when you multiply this expression through, so in this case you have 3 minus 4x. Please always write those things that you want to do when you're doing like, okay, multiplying through by x plus 3 times x minus 2. So well, I've said it already, please pay attention to it. So when you multiply with this, if you cancel out, so we have 3 minus 4x left here. So when you multiply in this situation, x plus 3 will cancel out x plus 3. So we have a times x minus 2 remaining. Plus, the next stage is, when you multiply this with this, then you have x minus 2 cancelling out. So we have, you're left with b, in bracket, x plus 3. Now from this expression, I want to solve for our a and b. It's a method I like very well, is comparing the coefficients. But to save our time here, we can choose to use this formula. Now, for every one thing you should notice is that for every constant here, there's something associated with it. I will still use the comparing coefficients method. So let me just write this equation here, and so that I'll pick it later. 3 minus 4x equals ax minus 2b x plus 3. The reason I want to teach us the comparing coefficient method is because there's some crazy expression I will get here that if you want to be doing what I want to do now, you end up wasting your time. I don't have any time to waste in the exam. So you just come and look at the, you have constant A here, you have constant B here. We want to get rid of, in fact, every other constant that is present there apart from just one constant. So, but fortunately for us here, we have two constants, so we get rid of one for the other. If I want to get rid of B now, I just need to alter the value of X, do something for X, and B will disappear. If I want to get rid of A, all I need to do is what? Alter the value of X and A will disappear. So let's choose which one. Now, in this case, what will make this thing to disappear is if I make X equals 2. If you make X equals to 2, then A will disappear because that will be 2 minus 2, I'll have 0. So you can say let X equals 2. That implies that 3 minus 8, because 4 times 2 is 8, will be equals, this one will vanish, then we have B multiplied by, that's 2 plus 3, that's 5. This implies that 5B equals, 3 minus 8 is minus 5, which implies that B equals minus 1. And the other way around too, you just say let X equal, so if this would vanish, so X will just be minus 3. So let X equals to minus 3. So we have 3 minus 4 times minus 3, that's 12, plus 12, that's plus 12, equals 3 minus 2 is 1, so that's A, which implies that A equals 15. A equals 15. So now that we have our B equals minus 1 and A equals 15, so our problem is almost solved. So we just insert the value of A. A is what? 15. So we have 15 over X plus 3. Minus 1 over x minus, where did I get that? Because this is plus, so but b is minus 1, so that will just be minus 1 over x minus 2. And with this, we have resolved into partial fraction. That's it, it's as simple as you see that it's very, very easy. So, let me quickly tell you what I want to do. What the comparing coefficient method, let me show you the comparing the coefficient method. I believe we have gotten this part. Oh my god, we got 15 and minus 1. So let's see if we get 15 and minus 1 too when we compare the coefficients. So we should get 15 and minus 1. So this place will have 3 minus 4x equals, so we open brackets here, we have ax minus 2a plus bx plus 3b. So we have this. Now, what would I do is that I'll look for terms there, I'll look for terms on the right hand side. Now, the terms that I have is just like I'm collecting like terms. Do you grab that? Like I'm collecting like terms, but not really in that sense. Now, I'll just be like, for the terms on the left hand side that has a particular term, I will equate them to the term on the right hand side that have the same that have the same thing, that share something in common. Look at this place now. This minus 4 has x. So everything that is multiplied with x here, I mean x, just ordinary x, and not with any power, and we equate them together. I imply that minus 4x will be equal to, so if you trace this, the first guy here is ax, a has x with it. Minus 2a, no, it doesn't have any x, it's a constant. Bx, yeah, so plus bx, is there anything? No. And as you can see, if you do this very well, you have minus 4x equals, because x is common, a plus b into bracket x, and this implies that a plus b equals minus 4, because the x will cancel out. So you can call this one equation 1. Then, this constant term does not have x at all, I'll just trace that as well. 3 equals, so we have, no, minus 2a, it doesn't have anything, it's a constant term as well, plus bx plus 3b. So we have plus 3b. Plus 3b. So this is like equation 2. So all we have to do is what? Is to solve these equations simultaneously. So let's quickly do that. A plus b equals minus 4, then minus 2a plus 3b equals 3. So if I just multiply this equation through by 2, this implies that equation 2, equation 1, if I multiply it through by 2, I will have 2a plus 2b equals minus 8. Now, I don't want to waste my time teaching us simultaneous equation. I taught this during the math revision class. So this will be, and this will remain itself, minus 2a plus 3b equals 3. And by the time you add these two equations, because they have different signs, so this will be 0, and 2b plus 3b, that's 5b, minus 8 plus 3, that's 5. That's minus 5. So this implies that b equals minus 1. So if you substitute minus 1 into this equation, you see that you get 15 back as your a. So let's see if that's actually true. So b is minus 1. So I hope we've not made any mistake from what we did the other time. So here, when we wanted to look for, a, we substituted minus 3. So this is minus 3. Oh, you made a mistake there. So let's quickly correct that. So let's go ahead and let x equals minus 3. So if x equals to minus 3, then we have that. That's why I prefer using this one. You'll be able to check yourself. But this one, if you made a mistake, then that's all. So checking this now, we have x equals to minus 3. Then minus 3 plus 3, that will be 0. Minus 3 minus 2, that's minus 5. So we have minus 5a. Minus 5a. The mistake I made was that I inserted 3 instead of minus 3. And this one will be 3 plus 12. Because minus 4 times minus 3, that's plus 12. That's 15. So if I do the division now, that's 15 equals minus 5a. This implies that a equals minus 3. So the result we got the other time should have been minus 3, because a is minus 3 now, so that would be minus 3 over x plus 3 minus 1 over x minus 2. So this is the correct one. This is the correct one, because we made a mistake in finding our a the other time. So, and this is the correct one. And so if we complete these two now, putting minus 1 here, so we have a minus 1 equals minus 4. So a equals to minus 4 plus 1, that's minus 3. So that's our value of a and value of b. Please.